On behalf of Institute, I welcome you all for today's lecture. Today's lecture is part of the series that Institute has begun, that you can see challenges before Indian society. For today's lecture, we have Professor MAKARAND or PARANJAPE, who is the director of the Indian Institute of Advanced Studies, Shimla. We are happy for his acceptance to deliver a lecture. Now I invite director of the Institute, G.V. Pant Institute, Professor Badrinarayan, sir. Now I invite today's speaker, MAKARAND or PARANJAPE, and please come to the dais. Now I request Haribom to present bouquet to the speaker. Now I request Praveen Swami to present salvo to the speaker. Now I request Professor Kane Bhatt, sir, to welcome the speaker formally on behalf of Institute.
Friends, this is a great occasion for us to welcome Professor PARANJAPE in our institute. We are really delighted, sir. You are heading an institution which is one of the apex institution in the country. We were just talking, for the knowledge of the students, Indian Institute of Advanced Studies, Shimla, once upon a time used to be the house, summer house of Viceroy General of India. So Professor PARANJAPE is heading presently that institution. Very, very important topic he is going to deal with, that is Vivekananda. Vivekananda always believed Janmana Brahmana, Janma se Brahman baniye. Sorry, karma se brahman vanya, I'm very sorry. Karmana brahmana, karma se brahman vanya, janma se nahi. Agar aap janma se brahman hai, to aap zahar phailayenge samaj mein. Samaj ko ek nahi kar payenge. Mujhe jyada idea nahi hai, mera to Vivekananda se association ek chance hai. One PhD thesis on Vivekananda came to me way back then, 15 years from Madras University. Initially I declined, but the person insisted, I accepted. That took interest in Vivekananda. Then I tried to see his literature. I feel if someone has made available very, very difficult Vedas to the common public, that is Vivekananda. I thought similar about Patanjali, when he was initially doing pranayama, yoga, but later on he has become a businessman now. I have no comments for that. Very towering personality. We are really delighted, sir. We hope to listen to you very attentively, and we look forward for your lecture. Your formal introduction will be given by Suchitra, our research scholar. We also appreciate the efforts of our director, who calls upon such scholars from time to time to visit the institute. Thank you very much. Hope you all will be benefited from this lecture. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Now we have a book launch program. We have two books. One is edited book that is a part of the series that Institute has organized. The first book is Mapping Social Gauge, Discourses on Culture and Democracy, edited by Professor Badrinarayan and Professor K. N. Bhatt. And we have another more book, lecture delivered by the Professor Ruprek Verma, that is Nari or Asmita. I request Paranjape and director and K. N. Bhatt to release these two books. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Now I request Suchitra, who is a PhD scholar in the institute, to introduce today's speaker.
Thank you, sir. Good morning, everybody. Before I introduce you to an eminent speaker present today amongst us, let me read out a stanza from one of his poetic work. To shut myself off from what is only too real is an occasional bliss, but every day the constant assault of the world, the daily confusion, the violence, and the madness of things persist unabated, until I realized at last that I must be responsible for all this. This is an apt summarization of the understanding of the social reality and truly portrays the characteristic of social realism in today's social structure, which shows the sensitivity, immense knowledge, and proficiency of our speaker. With this, let me introduce Professor MAKARAND PARANJAPE to all. Professor MAKARAND PARANJAPE, before assuming charge as director of Indian Institute of Advanced Study, Shimla, was teaching at the Center of English Studies at JNU, New Delhi, where he has been professor since 1999. Prior to that, he was associate professor, Department of Humanities and Social Science, IIT Delhi, and fellow researcher and fellow lecturer and reader in University of Hyderabad, 86 to 94. Professor Paranjpe has earned his master's and doctorate from the University of Illinois, Urbana-Champaign, USA, after a first-class BA honors in English from St. Stephen's College, University of Delhi. He completes his schooling from Bishop Compton Boys School, Bengaluru, and pre-university from Madras Christian College, Chennai. Professor Paranjpe is the author of nearly 20 books of literary criticism, poetry, fiction, and literary non-fiction, in addition to being the editor of over 24 other works of variety of topics. He has produced original and defining works on several makers of modern Indian literature and culture, including Rabindranath Tagore, Swami Vivekananda, Sri Aurobindo, Mahatma Gandhi, Sarojini Naidu, and Raja Rao. He is also interested in large social, philosophical, and civilizational issues. He has published close to 175 academic papers, published in prior review journals abroad, as well as leading Indian journals and book chapters. His popular articles, essay, book reviews, and medals number closest to 1,000 and have appeared in nearly every major newspaper in India, including the Times of India, Economic Times, to name a few. His recent book publication includes Debating the Post Condition in India, Critical Vernacular, Unauthorized Modernities, Post-Colonial Contentions, Cultural Politics in Modern India, Post-Colonial Prospect, to name a few. Apart from books in criticism, Professor MAKARAND has also published 6 poetry collections and works of fiction. Amongst his latest creative writing publication are Transit Passenger and the novel Body Offering. His edited book includes Swami Vivekananda, A Contemporary Reader, and Healing Across Boundaries. In this past decade, Professor Paranjpe has been an Andrew Mellon Fellow at the University of Texas at Austin, June to July 18. There are so many things to it. So with this, let me now request you to take the dais and enlighten us with your talk. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you so much. Thank you for that very generous introduction, which was almost interminable. And I thought that we should get on to the main object of today's lecture, especially because I have to catch a flight after this. So thank you so much, Professor Badri Narayanji, all of you, all the other faculty colleagues, and thank you to my young friends for coming here this morning. Sabse pehle to main GB Pant Sansthan ko badhaiyan aur shubhkamnaen dena chahta hoon, kyunki unka sthapana divas kal hai. So, तो लगभग 40 साल का योगदान रहा है इस संस्थान का और उम्मीद कर सकते हैं कि आगे के 40 वर्ष भी बहुत अच्छे बीतेंगे खास करके अभी जिस तरह की लीडरशिप है नेतृत्व है इंस्टीट्यूट का भविष्य बहुत ही उज्जवल लग रहा है मुझे शायद आप लोग भी इससे सहमत हो आई विल नाउ कम टू द टॉक which is Swami Vivekananda and the question of Indian modernity. A part of this is going to appear in this book called Swami Vivekananda, Hinduism and India's Road to Modernity. So, kal GB Pant Sansthan ka sthapana divas hai. Lekin parson kya hai, ye bataiye. Koi bhi bata sakte hain. जी बहुत बढ़िया कहाँ लेक्चर दिया था शिकागो में एग्जैक्टली इन 1893 ऑन द 11th ऑफ सितंबर ही गेव अ लेक्चर एट द वर्ल्ड्स पार्लियामेंट ऑफ रिलीजन्स यस बट और क्या हुआ था यस 9/11 वेरी गुड So you see, this can be a very good starting point for our talk today. If you understand what 9/11 was, when these jet airliners were hijacked and they crashed into the twin towers of the World Trade Center. I've been on top of those towers, by the way. And wahan se New York ka jo drishya hota tha, wo ekdam adbhut tha. In a way that wo jo twin towers the, wo jo paschatya sanskriti aur sabhyata hai, uska prateek the. And that, in some ways, represented the power of Western modernity, you see. Similarly, in 1893, the Columban exhibition, of which the world's Parliament of Religions was a part, was also meant to showcase modernities, the West's achievements, not only in the fields of science, technology, but also in the fields of arts and religion. And very interestingly, there was a book by a man called Jode, J-O-A-D, C.M. Jode, I think. And the book was called Counter-Attack from the West, from the East, I beg your pardon. Counter-Attack from the East. And is kitab ka shirshak, A.L. Basham ne usko chuna. A.L. Basham kaun the, bataiye, his history ke kaun vidyarthi hai? जी आप नहीं बताएंगे मृत्युंजय जी आप तो टीचर हो गए स्टूडेंट्स में कोई होगा तो बताएंगे एल बैशम का नाम सुना है आर्थर लेवेलन बैशम कौन थे जी आप बताएं सॉरी द वंडर दैट वाज इंडिया थैंक यू सो मच फुल मार्क्स सो द वंडर दैट वाज इंडिया के ऑथर थे ही वाज अ ब्रिटिश हिस्टोरियन हु देन वेंट टू कैनबरा Australian National University, Canberra, and he trained a generation of Indian students. But you may not know that he passed away in India. And he was actually given the Vivekananda chair in the Ramakrishna Mission Institute of Culture in Gold Park. And he made a point that why was Vivekananda great? He said he was even greater than Chaitanya, Kabir, and Nanak, which we may not agree with, by the way. But this is what A.L. Basham said. He said Vivekananda's contribution was great because he led the counter-attack from the East. That was the title of C.M. Jode's book, which Basham picked up. So what I'm trying to say is there were two counter-attacks from the East on 9/11. One counter-attack was by Vivekananda in 1893. The other counter-attack was by Al-Qaeda on another 9/11 in 2001, so many years later. What is the difference between these two counter-attacks from the East? That is the subject of my talk. And to give you a very quick summary, the point is this, that modernity, whether you consider it a singular modernity spreading itself across the world, or you consider it a polygenetic modernity, that is, modernity with multiple points of origin and dispersion. Which of these two theories, whichever of these two theories you agree with, the question is, how do you face or manage modernity? Can you bypass modernity? Can you escape it? Or do you succumb to it? Do you embrace it? Many in India tried to embrace modernity. They were modernizers. One of the most prominent and famous modernizers was associated with this very city. He was born here. I'm talking of Jawaharlal Nehru. And it is his father, Motilal Nehru, born after the Great Revolt of 1857, born in the 1860s, who actually turned westward, because his father, Jawaharlal's grandfather, was a Kotwal of the last Mughal emperor, Bahadur Shah Zafar. And after the Great Revolt, there was great turmoil in Delhi, and it is believed that the Nehru's home in the old city of Shahjahanabad was ransacked, looted, and burnt. The family came to Agra, and later, of course, to Allahabad. The point is that Motilal was a posthumous child. He was born after his father's death. And his elder brother had already started working in the district courts in Allahabad as a pleader. And you see how this family changed its allegiance from the Persian, Mughal, Muslim-dominated feudal order to the new order dominated by the British and Western modernity. It is no surprise that Jawaharlal Nehru, educated at Eton, Harrow, and Cambridge, became a great proponent of Western modernity, including Western science. So much so that he had the cultivation of a scientific temperament introduced and installed into the Indian constitution itself. So there were those who championed, embraced Western modernity, like Jawaharlal Nehru. There were those who critiqued Western modernity, his own so-called guru, Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi or Mahatma Gandhi, wrote a powerful critique of modernity in Hind Swaraj, written and published in 1909, on the way from England to South Africa. He wrote this book on a ship called the SS Kildonan Castle. And in that, he says that Western modernity, which is a product of the industrial civilization, is godless and immoral and has the seeds of self-destruction in it. So you have this powerful critique of modernity and you have the embracing or championing of modernity by his heir apparent, Jawaharlal Nehru. And they disagreed on this. And Gandhi said, since we disagree so much, let's make our disagreement public. Nehru refused. Unme jo dwand tha, wo public mein wo lana nahi chahte the, Jawaharlal Nehru. Lekin unke vichar mein bahut antar tha. Gandhi ji jab guzar gaye, unko mara gaya, uske baad Jawaharlal Nehru ne kya kiya? Unhone 5-year plans banaye aur Soviet model of development apnaya. Which brings me to the second point about Western modernity. The rise of Western modernity was characterized by internal contradictions. Antar dvand usme nihit tha. Kaisa? For example, with the rise of capitalism was also the critique of capitalism. The most powerful critique of capitalism came out of modernity by Marx, Engels, and others. So what I'm trying to say, and similarly, the most powerful critique of rationality, which was enshrined by the European Enlightenment, was also mounted from within modernity. Earlier by Nietzsche, and later by Foucault and Derrida and others. So you see, modernity ke antar dvand hote hain. Aur wo antar dvand bhi export hote hain. Unka bhi niryat hota hai. Jaise Bharat mein, jab liberalism ko export kiya gaya, Europe se, तो वो उसके अंतर्द्वंद्वों के साथ लिबरलिज्म भारत में आया. You see, on the one hand, you talked about liberty, equality, and fraternity. If you go to the Mahad Satyagrah of Baba Sahib Bhimrao Ambedkar, he quotes the French Revolution. You see the power of the Western Enlightenment and modernity. And yet, where was liberty for colonial subjects? Uday Mehta has written a book about this. So all these great ideas, including modern science, which is the driver, science and technology, which are the drivers of Western modernity, are full of internal contradictions. Unme antar dvand nihit hai. To kehne ka matlab ye hai ki modernity jab agrasar hui, all over the world modernity spread. It spread with its contradictions. Aur in antar dvandon ke karan bahut hinsa hui. Duniya bhar mein hinsa hui. Kaise? For example, most of the aboriginal peoples of the world could not survive the onslaught of modernity. North America, South America, these people were systematically decimated. There was a silent genocide. Ispe bahut kitabe likhi hai. Aap kitab padhiye, American genocide. Wahan bataya jayega ki the so-called Indians of America, उनका क्या हुआ और कितने कम बचे हैं. First Nations rights वगैरह अभी हम बात करते हैं उनकी. Basically, the systematic erasure and destruction of the people who could not make it past the bar that modernity placed, you see, on them. These people were destroyed. The Aborigines of Australia, of New Zealand, because the Maoris were very strong, they could survive. India mein bhi, jo hamare janjati aur adivasi log hain, wo kis tarah bach paaye, ye apne aap badi kahani hai. Aur iske kuch sanskritik karan hai, frankly. So modernity spread disease and violence amongst the ancient peoples of the world so that they were almost wiped out. And when it came to India, it came via colonialism. So the point that I'm trying to make is that modernity moves in systemic and counter-systemic ways. So when you hate modernity, the dispossessed people for whom modernity was a curse, who are victims of modernity, like the Australian indigenous people, who when they woke up from dreaming, unke consciousness ko dreaming bolte hain. If you've read Australian literature and anthropology, when you wake up from the dream, you don't wake up into reality that is modernity. You wake up into a never-ending nightmare. So basically, the two binary or oppositional dialectical manner in which modernity spread was through systemic and counter-systemic ways. Marxism was counter-systemic. And when there was a clash, you know, whether you want to call it socialism or communism, these were destroyed. They have been destroyed. And if they exist in India, they still exist on borrowed time. Can you imagine how China created private property? The state created private property after abolishing private property. So imagine a communist state creating private property. It is something that even Marx would never have dreamt of, let alone foretold in his worst nightmare. So what happens is when there's a clash of the systemic and counter-systemic, usually there's no synthesis, like Hegel said. One is defeated. So similarly, the reaction of Al-Qaeda to the World Trade Center is a counter-systemic reaction to modernity. And the clash of civilizations that Huntington talked about is still going on. But the attack from the East led by Vivekananda was totally different. This is the point. So if you read what Hegel said and after Hegel, what Husserl and Heidegger said, they argued that the relentless march of Western modernity spreading itself across the world was inevitable. For Hegel, it was a triumphalistic march, something to be celebrated. By the time you come to Heidegger or Max Weber, it's actually fraught with an elegiac sadness because of the disenchantment of the world. And how do you re-enchant the world? This is a very big question, right? And I think that the reason that Vivekananda and a few other thinkers like him are extremely important is they give you a third way of dealing with modernity. To sum up the first part of my presentation, modernity presents you some unenviable options. Either you succumb to it and are enslaved by it, you embrace it, you champion it. Many, many modernizers in India represent that faction or that position. Or you resist it. You become counter-systemic. You want to throw a spanner in the works. And yet, you love the technology. You love the so-called asuric power of modernity. Like Iran does. It's an Islamic revolutionary state, but they want the nukes. That's the counter-systemic attack on modernity. You call America the great Satan, but you want the drones, you want the surveillance, you want the cyber warfare, you want the bombs, but you hate America, you hate its values. So you embrace it, you hate it, you want to bring it down. But I think India represents the third way, the best of India, because I would say 80% of India hasn't understood modernity. I'm talking about intellectual India. You see, the victims of modernity are all around you. Maine ek article likha hai jisme maine bataya कि हम इसरो की इतनी प्रशंसा करते हैं लेकिन उसकी दीवारें देखिए उसको लांघना कितना मुश्किल है। आपके पास वो स्पेशल आईडी लगेगा फिंगरप्रिंट लगेगा कोई किसान धोती पहन के इसरो में नहीं आ सकता। बाहर आप देखेंगे तो कंफ्यूजन है केओस है गंद है लेकिन अंदर आप देखेंगे तो एक सैनिटाइज्ड वातावरण मिलेगा जहाँ पे आपको ग्लव्स पहनना पड़ेगा। तो इंडियन साइंस हैज नॉट बीन अब्सॉर्ब बाय द इंडियन सिविलाइजेशन मॉडर्न साइंस नॉट इंडियन साइंस। सो प्लीज लेट्स अंडरस्टैंड दिस थर्ड वे कि मॉडर्निटी को समझना उसको पचाना और उसका निवारण करना इतनी शक्ति जिस विचार में हो सकती है वही मॉडर्निटी से डील कर सकता है। नहीं तो आपके पास दो ही विकल्प है या तो आप उसके शिकार बन जाइए यू बिकम द सब्जेक्ट ऑफ मॉडर्निटी और यू बिकम सम काइंड ऑफ फनेटिक द विक्टिम ऑफ अ री इन्वेंटेड ट्रेडिशन एंड यू वॉन्ट टू ब्रिंग पुट अ बॉम्ब एंड डिस्ट्रॉय इट। ये जो थर्ड वे है दिस इज वाई विवेकानंदा इज इम्पॉर्टेंट। So of the two counter attacks from the east, it is this counter attack that we should really think of and focus on. Now I will read you just a few sections taki you get a flavor of the kind of discourse I'm talking about. And these may be some random sections because samay kam hai and then we can have a Q&A. So I have three parts to this paper and it is impossible to present all of them. The first is called Modernity Revisited, the second is called India's Response to Modernity and the third is what Vivekananda contributed. So I will give you some paragraphs aapko pesh karunga just for you to get a flavor of it. The heterogeneous character of modernity renders it virtually impossible to understand or define fully. We must content ourselves with a series of intelligent if fragmentary generalizations, most of which will tend to be reductive if not essentialist. That modernity was an invention seems incontrovertible. Its invention may not have been a deliberate act by an identifiable set of historical agents, but more like a process set in motion over centuries. Yet it was very much an invention in the same sense that Eric Hobsbawm and Theo Rangers showed that tradition was an invention. In fact, an intriguing implication of their work is that the difference between tradition and modernity is itself an invention. Now I'm going to read you one more thing that I want you to really think about. The fundamental invention that constitutes the core of modernity is that modernity freed its subjects from the hold of authority and the weight of the past. To put it more specifically, freedom is at the heart of the modern project. Yet, as Agnes Heller points out, modernity is founded on freedom and yet paradoxically has no foundation since it emerged in and through the destruction and deconstruction of all foundations. So how can you have an anti-foundationalist foundation? You see the paradox, jab maine kaha ke आधुनिकता के बीचों बीच एक अंतर्द्वंद है उसकी आत्मा में ही एक अंतर्द्वंद है। ये एंटी फाउंडेशनल फाउंडेशनलिज्म इज अ पार्ट ऑफ दैट कॉन्ट्रडिक्शन दैट इज मॉडर्निटी। लुक एट द सेकंड आउटकम ऑफ दिस कॉन्ट्रडिक्शन द फाउंडेशनल आइडिया ऑफ मॉडर्निटी विच इज फ्रीडम इज इटसेल्फ enframed within the idea of limit. Freedom is limited by its inability to surrender itself to authority. So aap ko authority manne ka freedom nahi hai. Jaise feminists kehte hain ki Sita ki agency nahi hai. Shri Ramchandra ko follow karne ki agency nahi hai. Sirf rebellion ko agency keh sakte hain. Aap please sochiye iske bare mein. Sartre summed up this irony in his own inimitable way in Being and Nothingness when he said, man is condemned to be free. Here, condemned may be read as bound. If you're bound to be free, you're not free. You see the contradiction of this anti-foundational foundation. And similarly, you think about the dialectic of enlightenment in which Theodore Adorno and Max Horkheimer said that enlightenment is tyranny, enlightenment is totalitarian, that rationality itself is irrational. Now I'm going to skip. And let us see now some of the key elements or themes of modernity. One, modernity is a conscious rejection of the past. This aspect of modernity, in tune with its etymological meaning, emphasizes its break with tradition. So as Kant said, sapere aude, dare to know. Two, the rise of science. Three, the modern state. Four, the relentless march of capital. So these are some of the features of modernity, okay? And now the second part, I'm skipping and, you know, moving fast, it's about 10:50, so that, you know, we can have a longer Q&A. The second part is called the Indian modern. When it comes to India, modernity is similarly invented and impacted by multiple aspects of the past, present and future. In addition, one of its peculiarities is that it is Janus-faced. So Janus is this Greek god who faces in two different directions. Vahi antardvan ki baat pehle jo maine ki, usi tarah modernity ke do rukh hai, aadhunikta ke do rukh hai. Ek to piche ki taraf dekh raha hai, hamesha. Your glorious past, you know, you want to revive that. How do you stake your claim to being a part of the modern world? You say, oh, we had a glorious past. Hamare paas ganit tha. हमारे पास आर्यभट्ट थे. इस तरह से आपका कॉन्फिडेंस, आत्मविश्वास बढ़ता है, आत्मबल बढ़ता है. आप समझ रहे हैं मेरी बात? सो यू लुक टू द पास्ट एंड येट यू लुक टू द फ्यूचर. द वेस्ट डिड द सेम थिंग. दे गॉट आउट ऑफ द क्रिश्चियन थियोलॉजिकल फ्रेमवर्क एंड दे वेंट टू द सेक्युलर लिटरेचर ऑफ द ग्रीक्स एंड रोमन्स टू इन्वेंट मॉडर्निटी. So Indian modernity looks to the past, it also looks to the future. Often it skips the medieval dark ages, right? So it is both chronologically and spatially two-faced. Chronologically, looking past, looking forward. Spatially, looking to the West and looking to itself. So Anant Murthy ji ne ek bahut achhi baat kahi thi, unka rupak diya tha unhone, ke sab log Bharat ki baat kar rahe hain, lekin hum log ek train mein hain, जैसे कि, और वो जो रेलगाड़ी है उसकी जो खिड़की है वहाँ पे एक ढलता सूरज है और आप पश्चिम की तरफ देखे जा रहे हैं, लेकिन आपकी जर्नी जो है वो ईस्ट की तरफ है. तो ये हमारा विरोधाभास है भारत में. हम सिर्फ भारत की बात करते हैं लेकिन हमारी निगाहें हमेशा पश्चिम की तरफ होती हैं. यहाँ तक कि जो लोग हमारे पुरातन समय, पुरातन काल के महत्व की बात करते हैं, वो भी हमेशा मैक्स मुलर या किसी आइंस्टाइन को कोट करेंगे, क्योंकि वो आत्मविश्वास नहीं है, है ना. भारत में अपने आप को पहचानने की अभी क्षमता पैदा ही नहीं हुई है. इसी को कॉलोनाइज्ड इंटेलेक्चुअल कहा जाता है. तो स्पेशली टू फेस्ड, लुकिंग टू द वेस्ट एंड लुकिंग टू योर सेल्फ. एंड देन इट इज ऑल्सो टू फेस्ड इन द सेंस दैट यू आर लुकिंग विद इन एंड देन यू आर लुकिंग आउटसाइड. ठीक है. Now, like European modernity, Indian modernity was also riddled with contradictions and paradoxes. Hinduism, not yet quite an ism, I'm talking about the early 19th century, nor fully reformed to survive in the new age, itself was under siege. Kaise? There were two attacks. One was religious and one was secular. So after the East India Company established its sovereignty and hold over most of India, you can date it when they defeated the Marathas in the Third Anglo-Maratha War in 1818. They said, now you can bring on the full might of the West. Earlier, the missionaries were banned from preaching in British India. That is why they set up shop in the Danish protectorate of Srirampur. Wahan se missionaries aate the, including the Baptist missionaries, Joshua Marshman, and the famous, what was the other guy? Irish brothers to baad mein aaye, they went to the Northeast. But the Baptist mission press was set up, you know, in Srirampur, what's called Serampur, the Serampur mission. एंड वहाँ से वो प्रचार, क्रिश्चियनिटी का प्रचार वहाँ से शुरू हुआ। तो दरअसल क्या था कि मिशनरीज को उन्होंने इजाज़त देना शुरू किया 1818 के बाद। उसके पहले नॉन ब्रिटिश टेरिटरीज से मिशनरी काम होता था। एंड यू नो जोशुआ मार्शमन एक थे और दूसरे एक थे, दीज टू पीपल केम एंड देयर वाज द स्कॉटिश रेनेसांस, सो हेयर स्कूल, यू नो बंगाल वाज इन अ फर्मेंट एंड देयर वर टू काइंड्स ऑफ एजुकेशन सिस्टम्स, वन वाज बाय अलेक्जेंडर हैमिल्टन व्हिच वाज अ सेक्युलर एजुकेशन एंड द अदर वाज द क्रिश्चियन एजुकेशन बाय द स्कॉटिश मिशनरी डेविड हेयर। सो ये सब सोचने की बात है। सो देयर वर टू अटैक्स, व्हाट आई एम ट्राइंग टू से इज वन अटैक वाज द मिशनरी अटैक ऑन इंडियन सिविलाइजेशन एंड द अदर अटैक वाज बाय मैकॉले, द सेक्युलर अटैक, एंड बोथ हैड द सेम प्रेमिस। द सेम प्रेमिस वाज दैट इंडियन सिविलाइजेशन was a rotten tree which had to be cut down. This metaphor is from Michael Madhusudan Datta, who converted to Christianity, and of course he came back, you know, to writing in Bangla and all that, and he is an important part of Ashish Nandi's wonderful book The Intimate Enemy, you know, the loss and recovery of self, you know, under colonialism. Yahi hota hai, the loss of self and then the recovery of self. This is that circular journey. Ward and Marshman, these were the two people who were in the Baptist mission who came to Serampore, and they had the press there. They started the press. In the south, there was the Basel mission from Switzerland which came. And Bishop Caldwell and the others started the Dravidian movement. So you have to see this total attack. And the Dravidian movement then led to self-respect and then led to the political Dravidianism like Periyar and others. And you'll see that wherever these movements attacking the ancient, whatever civilization of India flourished, their conversion became easy. So this is a very big, I don't want to call it conspiracy, but when you want to rule people, how do you establish hegemony? So ye sochne ki baatein hain. But these two attacks, one religious, one secular, resulted in the typical converted Hindu. So one kind of Hindu converted, like Krishnamohan Banerjee or Madhusudan Datta, they became Christian. The other kind became secular. But the secular conversion was not any less significant than the religious conversion, because the secular conversion also leads to deracination and self-loathing and self-contempt. Please see what I'm saying. So the challenge of modernity was to produce a third response by a logical positivist like Vivekananda, trained in presidency and later the Scottish Mission College, and within quotes reconverted by Ramakrishna. How? Not through any intellectual knowledge, but Ramakrishna put his foot on his chest and he went into a trance. तो आप कहेंगे जादू टोना कर दिया, कह सकते हैं आप. And Vivekananda said, what are you doing? I still have my mother, I have people to look after. Please restore me to normal consciousness. आप महेंद्रनाथ गुप्त की किताब पढ़िए. And रामकृष्ण कथामृत, ये अंग्रेजी में भी उपलब्ध है, आप पढ़िए. तो conversion दो तरह से होता है, एक तो कॉलेजेस में होता है, यूनिवर्सिटीज में कन्वर्जन होता है, जो सेक्युलर कन्वर्जन की बात कर रहा हूँ, है ना, उस तरह का कन्वर्जन होता है. हम सब ने एक दौर में वो उससे हम गुजरे हैं, हमने भी मार्क्स पढ़ा है, ये पढ़ा है, वो पढ़ा है, लेनिन पढ़ा है. आजकल तो कोई पढ़ता नहीं है, वो बात अलग है, पढ़ना बहुत ज़रूरी है, पढ़ना और सोचना बहुत ज़रूरी है. हम अभी सोच बना नहीं पाए हैं, अभी बना रहे हैं, कोशिश कर रहे हैं. तो एक तो वो कन्वर्जन होता है. दूसरा कन्वर्जन ये होता है जब कोई महापुरुष है, आप उनके सान्निध्य में बैठते हैं, कुछ कहने की आवश्यकता नहीं है, लेकिन आपकी जो कॉन्शियसनेस है, चेतना है, जो बुद्धि है, या आपका जो स्टेट ऑफ माइंड है, उसमें परिवर्तन आता है और आपको समझ भी नहीं आता है. और जब तक आप इसको अनुभव नहीं करेंगे, आपको ये समझ भी नहीं आएगा. मेरे साथ भी हुआ, इसलिए मैं कह रहा हूँ. एक बहुत बड़े हमारे विचारक थे भारत के, शायद आपने उनका नाम सुना होगा, रामचंद्र गांधी. तो वो महात्मा गांधी के ग्रैंडसन थे, देवदास गांधी के पुत्र थे और राजमोहन के छोटे भाई थे. तो ही स्टार्टेड ऑफ एज एन एनालिटिकल फिलोसोफर एंड ट्रेन्ड विद स्ट्रॉसन. बहुत उनकी अच्छी पेडिग्री रही, ऑक्सफर्ड पढ़े, दो पीएचडी की उन्होंने. लेकिन फिर उनके मन में परिवर्तन आया जब वो रमण महर्षि के शरण में गए. और आपको एक किताब पढ़नी चाहे, आई एम दाओ, वो किताब पढ़िए आप. ये इतनी अद्भुत किताब है कि भारत, आधुनिक भारत में के बुद्धि मतलब जो विचरण में या डिस्कर्सिव वर्ल्ड में ऐसी किताब ही नहीं है. वो आप थोड़ा सा पढ़ के देखिए. सो ही कॉल्ड रमण महर्षि द ग्रेटेस्ट माइंड स्लेयर ऑफ आर टाइम्स. तो इस तरह का कुछ परिवर्तन आ गया विवेकानंद में. एंड देन ही बिकेम द इंजन ऑफ द काउंटर अटैक फ्रॉम द ईस्ट. कि वेस्टर्न मॉडर्निटी को अपने आप से बचाने का क्या रास्ता है, ये प्रश्न आता है. अब आप रामकृष्ण मिशन की बात देखिए. सम मे कॉल इट अ न्यू ट्रेडिशनलिस्ट ऑर्गेनाइजेशन, बट इट इज अ वेरी मॉडर्न इंस्टीट्यूशन. It has adopted several fundamental principles of modernity and also drawn from the West and Christianity. ये mission का ही नाम आप देख लीजिए, Ramakrishna mission. ये mission क्या होता है? और Vedant for the service of mankind or humanity, ये क्या होता है? Service orientation कहाँ से आया Vedant का? तो जब स्वामी जी अमेरिका गए और उन्होंने उस समाज को देखा और परखा, तब उनको लगा कि ऑर्गेनाइजेशन इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. तो जब वापस आते हैं, एंड व्हेन रामकृष्ण मिशन वॉज फाउंडेड इन 1900 एंड आई थिंक इन मे और जून, आई कांट रिमेम्बर, किताब में है, तब उनके गुरु भाई योगानंद, बाय द वे विवेकानंद अलाहाबाद भी आए थे प्रयागराज, और वही योगानंद जिसकी मैं बात कर रहा हूँ वो यहाँ बीमार पड़ गए थे, उनको मलेरिया हुआ था. तो विवेकानंद नर्स्ड हिम. एंड फिर उनको लगा, ही केम हियर इन हिज परिव्राजक डेज बिफोर 1893. तो उनको तब लगा यहाँ तो कुछ नहीं है अलाहाबाद में, और गाजीपुर चले गए. वहाँ एक पवहरी बाबा थे, तो उनके स्टोरी में वो आता है कि ही वेंट टू सी पवहरी बाबा इन गाजीपुर. यहाँ से बनारस होते ईस्ट चले गए थे विवेकानंद. तो विवेकानंद का भी यहाँ से कुछ ताल्लुक है, और यहाँ रामकृष्ण मिशन भी है. बट योगानंद जो यहाँ बीमार पड़े थे, उन्होंने विवेकानंद को पूछा कि हमको ठाकुर यानी रामकृष्णा ने ये तो नहीं सिखाया था, एकोने बोने कोने. उन्होंने कहा था क्या करना है, अकेले बैठो वन में, यानी कहीं दूर जंगल में बैठो या कहीं कोने में बैठो और अपने आप को जानो एंड बिकम सेल्फ रियलाइज. दैट इज द गोल ऑफ लाइफ. दिस इज वॉट ठाकुर सेड. सो चाकरी मत करो, ब्रिटिशों की चाकरी मत करो. दिस वॉट ही सेड. कामिनी कंचन से बचो. यहाँ कामिनी मतलब ऑल्सो मेल, इफ यू आर अ वुमन. दैट इज टू से दैट गोल्ड एंड यू नो वट एवर यू वॉन्ट टू कॉल इट सेक्शुअलिटी से बच के रहना चाहिए. दिस वॉज द टीचिंग ऑफ रामकृष्णा, विच इज अनपॉपुलर टूडे बिकॉज वी आर सो हीडनिस्टिक. एवरीबडी वॉन्ट्स टू से आज की पाठशाला मस्ती की पाठशाला, राइट? यू मस्ट हैव सीन दैट फिल्म रंग दे बसंती. तो यही आज का इथोस वही है. लेकिन व्हाट आई एम ट्राइंग टू से इज दैट द रामकृष्ण मिशन इज अ वेरी मॉडर्न ऑर्गेनाइजेशन बिकॉज विवेकानंदा थॉट दैट हिंदुइज्म का बचाव नहीं हो सकता अनलेस यू कंप्लीटली रीटूल इट, यू चेंज इट कंप्लीटली. एंड येट इट इज प्रेमिस्ड ऑन द नोशन ऑफ अवतारहुड विच यू कैनॉट एक्सेप्ट एज अ मॉडर्न पर्सन अनलेस you talk about charismatic authority. That's what Weber talks about. But charismatic authority is to be suspected because it's like Hitler. Wo to cult banati hai. So please think about these things. Raghuram Raju, one of my former colleagues from Hyderabad, has written a book in which he picks up what Ashish Nandi says, that Vivekananda was a more divided man than Ramakrishna. Because dealing with more divided men, Vivekananda was more troubled, having gone to the West, understood its material superiority, understood the magnitude of the challenge it posed to India, and how far, to what extent, all of us had become divided men and women. And therefore, there are more inconsistencies, confusions, and ambiguities, according to Raju. So this is Raghuram Raju, not Raghuram Rajan, okay? So Raghuram Raju is a professor of philosophy in Hyderabad, not the ex-governor of Reserve Bank of India. And the assertion of Indian spiritual religious superiority was one way to shore up the self-esteem of a defeated people. And therefore, you have this interesting variation about the self-sufficiency of Indic civilization based on the avataric intervention of great spiritual leaders and gurus like Ramakrishna. So if you look at modern India, till we were colonized, we had a whole line of hugely innovative spiritual masters. It's not just Ramakrishna, Swami Narayan, today all the Akshardhams all over the world. There was a unique person called Swami Narayan who came from, a region near Ayodhya and was initiated by one of the members of the tradition, sampradaya of Ramanuja, Sri Vaishnav Sampradaya se unko initiation mila. Aur see what he has produced. Aur ISKCON, uski bhi jade wahi pe hain. The guru of Srila Prabhupada and his guru, they were part of that same Bengal Renaissance. And then in the south, Ramalinga Swami, Raman Maharishi, then Sai Baba, itne sare log ubhre us zamane mein. Kyun? क्योंकि ये जो मॉडर्निटी आधुनिकता की चुनौती थी उसको पचाना और कुछ हमारी तरफ से रिस्पांस देना अनिवार्य था. As the great Bankim Chandra Chattopadhyay himself said to Ramakrishna, so Bankim means टेढ़ा, है ना, बांके बिहारी, जो टेढ़े है ना, क्योंकि श्री कृष्ण थोड़े टेढ़े होते हैं, त्रिभंग उनकी मुद्रा होती है ना. तो श्री रामकृष्णा कहते हैं तुम बंकिम क्यों हो, तुम टेढ़े क्यों हो. तो वो क्या जवाब देते हैं कि हमारे जो कॉलोनियल उपनिवेशिक, हमारे जो मास्टर्स हैं उनकी लाते खाके मैं टेढ़ा बन गया हूँ. कैन यू थिंक अबाउट हाउ फार रीचिंग दिस इज. हम लोगों ने सब उनकी लाते खाई है इसलिए हम भी टेढ़े हो गए हैं. हम अपने आप के लिए सोच नहीं सकते. So Sri Ramakrishna said, Chakri mat karo. Why is he saying it? This is the early version of Swaraj. To main bhi kehta hoon, intellectuals anek kisam ke hote hain. Ek to statist intellectual hota hai, hai na? Aur ek wo hota hai NGO intellectual. Wo NGO se hi usko milta hai sab kuch. Phir ek western oriented hai, British Council, Fulbright, Ford Foundation. इससे ही उसकी उन्नति होती है. तो स्वराजिस्ट इंटेलेक्चुअल बनिए, बहुत कम होते हैं. स्वराजिस्ट इंटेलेक्चुअल भी एक परंपरा है. अब आई कम टू द लास्ट पार्ट विच इज विवेकानंदास कॉन्ट्रीब्यूशन. मैंने ऑलरेडी जिक्र किया है द काउंटर अटैक फ्रॉम द वेस्ट. सो बैशम सेज विवेकानंदा वॉज द फर्स्ट इंडियन रिलीजियस टीचर इन रिसेंट टाइम्स टू मेक एन इम्प्रेशन आउटसाइड इंडिया. प्लीज इसके बारे में सोचिए. So if it is the Dalai Lama today, Sri Sri Ravi Shankar, Yogananda, Muktananda, koi bhi ho jinhone West pe impact kiya, ISKCON also, the first significant East to West movement was Vivekananda's. Theosophy West to East hai, please sochiye iske baare mein. And that is why he said Vivekananda is so important. Ke Sanatan dharm kahiye, Hindu dharm kahiye, Baudh dharm kahiye, kuch bhi, ये इतना संकीर्ण हो चुका था. या आफ्टर द इस्लामिक कॉन्क्वेस्ट इट वॉज सो इनवर्ड लुकिंग दैट आफ्टर अ थाउजेंड ईयर्स इट वेंट आउट अगेन बिकॉज ऑफ विवेकानंदा. और ही वॉज द एजेंट, यू कांट से दैट ही डिड इट. ही वॉज द एजेंट ऑफ समथिंग वेरी बिग. द फोर्स बिहाइंड विवेकानंदा वॉज अ मच बिगर फोर्स. दैट वॉज द पॉइंट. तो हम लोग तो थर्ड वर्ल्ड भी रहे, द मॉडर्न वर्ल्ड इज़ नॉट आर क्रिएशन. और मैं आपको चैलेंज करता हूँ, इस कमरे में जो जो चीज़ें हैं उपयोगी चीज़ें हैं, ये सारे वेस्ट में बनी हैं. आप अपना आईफोन निकालिए, ये मैकबुक निकालिए, ये माइक निकालिए, ये पंखा जिसमें मोटर है, जिसमें इलेक्ट्रिसिटी की वजह से चलता है, ये लाइट है, इसमें एक टंगस्टन कॉइल है, ये प्लास्टिक है, ये सारा वेस्ट ने दिया है, आपने कुछ नहीं किया इसमें. प्लीज़ डोंट डिल्यूड योरसेल्फ. जो एयर कंडीशनर है पीछे, कैरियर नाम के आदमी ने बनाया, ही वॉज एन अमेरिकन इन टेक्सस, ही सेड इट्स सो हॉट, व्हाट कैन आई डू. सो ही हैड दीज, यू नो, अ फ्लूइड रनिंग थ्रू कूलिंग पाइप्स एंड द एयर वेंट ओवर इट. प्लास्टिक रेवोल्यूशन, केमिकल रेवोल्यूशन हैपेंड इन द 1880s, 1890s विद पीपल लाइक डूपॉन्ट. लाइट्स वर इन्वेंटेड बाय एडिसन एंड अदर पीपल. ये हमारी विशाल संस्कृति ने कोई योगदान आधुनिक दुनिया में नहीं दिया. और इतनी बड़ी अच्छी संस्कृति आप जानते हैं और कहते भी हैं, लेकिन आपको हर मॉडर्न वस्तु का लाभ उठाना है, उपभोग लेना है कि नहीं, बताइए. फिर तो प्लीज़ अपने आप को हमको पहचानना चाहिए. तो हम तो थर्ड वर्ल्ड के हैं, यानी वी आर नॉट क्रिएटर्स ऑफ मॉडर्निटी, वी आर ट्राइंग टू फाइंड अ वे इन इट. दिस इज द पॉइंट. So what did Vivekananda do? What was his contribution? He said that just as science is universal, can we make consciousness, spirituality, religion universal? Can it be falsifiable? Like Karl Popper said, science is verifiable and falsifiable. He says, can religious ideas be verifiable and falsifiable? So Vivekananda created a religious revolution. And he said that we have something to contribute to the modern world. What is it? You guys have given all this, but in at least 1893, the dominant Christian position was exclusivist. There was only one way. And it was so exclusivist that the Catholic Church, at least represented by the Vatican, did not send anybody to the Parliament of World Religions. Nor did the Anglican Church. The Bishop, Archbishop of Canterbury said, dialogue of religions ki kya zarurat hai? Hamare paas hai, satya hai. And the head of the Islamic world, the caliph, you know, of Turkey, us samay Arab world to tha nahi, petrol dollars nahi the, so it was all by the caliph. Khalifa said, hum kyun denge, we have the last prophet, the seal of the prophet is on us, why should we send somebody to the Parliament of World Religions? So only American denominations were represented, and not all of them. To usme Vivekananda aa gaye. और उन्होंने कहा, प्लीज ब्रॉडन योर होराइजंस, नोबडी हैज एन एक्सक्लूसिव क्लेम टू ट्रूथ. जस्ट अ साइंस सेज नोबडी हैज एन एक्सक्लूसिव क्लेम टू ट्रूथ. यू एक्सपेरिमेंट, इफ योर थियोरी इज फॉल्सिफाइड देन यू हैव टू हैव अ न्यू थियोरी, इफ इट इज वेरीफाइड इट ओनली लास्ट टिल इट इज नॉट फॉल्सिफाइड. सो ही सेड लेट्स डू द सेम फॉर रिलीजन. सो इस किताब में आई हैव मेड द आर्ग्यूमेंट दैट दिस इज अ डबल हीलिक्स that Vivekananda unleashed into the modern world. So one is the interfaith dialogue, so to speak, where he's trying to say that the Eastern pluralistic traditions are, within quotes, superior to the monistic and monotheistic traditions, instead of the other way around. We were always on the defensive. They said, you worship monsters. That's why everybody loves Salman Rushdie's Midnight's Children, because he makes India a menagerie of monsters. And yet he cannot understand India. Yahi vidambana hai. Padma's pickle jars are never filled. So what Vivekananda does is he says, look, in the dialogue amongst religions, the Eastern faiths are superior because they are giving you the mantra, ekam sat vipra bahudha vadanti. Pluralism. Religious pluralism is as important as pluralism in science, so to speak. That's one idea. The other idea is the science-religion dialogue. And he wanted to synthesize the two. Wo ho nahi paya. People think that quantum world mein hota hai, but puri tarah se hua nahi hai. To shabd praman jo hota tha, in Shankar, shabd praman ko varchasva diya jata hai. Yani shastra, shastron ko varchasva diya jata hai. You know, in epistemology, jab aap praman dekhte hain, hai na, pratyaksh praman hota hai. And pratyaksha praman doesn't mean aankhon dekhi sirf. Aankhon dekhi yani दिव्य चक्षु से भी कुछ दिखता है. इसीलिए मैंने कहा कि जब श्री रामकृष्णा ने उनका पैर रखा विवेकानंद पर तो समथिंग हैपन टू हिम. सो इट्स नॉट विद द लॉजिकल पॉजिटिविज्म ऑफ सेंसरी डाटा अलोन. सो ये सोचने की बात है. सो जो प्रमाणों की बात होती थी तो वेद प्रमाण को ऊंचा माना जाता था. बट वॉट विवेकानंदा डज इज नो अनुभव को ऊंचा मानते हैं. सो प्लीज सी द रेवोल्यूशन एंड देयर बाय एज भट्ट साहब सेड ही हैज फ्रीड यू फ्रॉम जातिवाद. यू नो ये कर्मणा को आपने स्वीकार करना है और जन्मना को नकारना है. और इससे क्या, ही वॉज अ ग्रेट सोशल रिफॉर्मर बट ही डिडंट से, ही सेड रेज अप एवरीबडी, डोंट ब्रिंग एवरीबडी डाउन. यू रीड विवेकानंदा एंड ही इज अगेंस्ट अधिकारवाद. दिस इज दैट जन्मना बिजनेस. अधिकारवाद यानी आप जन्म से अधिकारी है किसी ज्ञान के. एंड ही सेड इसको अब आपको छोड़ देना चाहिए, आधुनिक समय में ये नहीं चलेगा. सो मेरी कभी कभी बातचीत होती है बहुत बड़े लोगों से, शंकराचार्य से भी, और वो वही कहते हैं वर्णाश्रम धर्म को लाओ. तो मैंने कहा नहीं ला सकते आप, उसकी परिभाषा बदलनी पड़ेगी. जैसे हम वर्ण कहते हैं, वर्ण आपको, वर्ण माने क्या, यानी अगर मैं पुलिसमैन हूँ तो मुझे पुलिसमैन का धर्म करना है. इफ़ आई स्टार्ट टेकिंग ब्राइब्स, यू सी इट विल बी अ बिग कैटास्ट्रोफी एंड दिस व्हाट इज हैपनिंग इन इंडिया, यू नो. सो प्लीज थिंक अबाउट इट. उसकी परिभाषा बदलनी चाहिए एंड दिस व्हाट विवेकानंद डिड. सो ही सेड शब्द प्रमाण से अनुभव का प्रमाण ज़्यादा ऊँचा है. दिस इज द रेवोल्यूशन. सो नाउ लेट मी जस्ट कंक्लूड. इट्स 11:16, सो वी हैव अ लिटिल बिट ऑफ टाइम. So if I were to summarize not just Vivekananda's but India's contribution to modernity, I would call it the replacing of reason. What does replacing mean? Re dash, not dash but hyphen placing. Replace ka kya matlab hai? Replace ka matlab hai isko hatao usko lagao. But replacing yani uska sthan badlo, sthanantaran. तो जो ये रीज़न है, इंस्ट्रूमेंटल रैशनैलिटी है, ये बहुत घातक चीज़ है. बिकॉज इफ़ इट कैन मेक अ किलिंग मशीन एज इफेक्टिवली एज इट कैन मेक अ रेस्पिरेटर और अ वेंटिलेटर. द फर्स्ट किलिंग मशीन वॉज अ प्रोडक्ट ऑफ द यूरोपियन एनलाइटनमेंट. इट वॉज द गिलोटीन. बिकॉज वेन दे वॉन्टेड टू गेट रिड ऑफ द एंशियंट रेजीम, दे सेड हैंगिंग पीपल टेक्स टू मच टाइम. इसी लोगों को लटकाना, फिर वो ऐसे